demonstrate to you that this is what the council has in order to demonstrate that it is complying with all aspects of the code. And the details of the code, and indeed the evidence relied upon and those responsible for it, are set out in Appendix 1 to the report. You'll see the code is divided into seven categories. If I may just simply highlight to you the key changes that are to be set out in paragraph 3.6 of the report. And those are the two key areas that are changed. Overall, also, the code is very similar to the code that we do have already in place, but it does provide a little bit more clarity and a little bit more information around those key areas around D and G of the seven principles of the code. If I can refer you, therefore, to the actual appendix itself, that sets out the preamble in terms of what the code is for, its purpose, and what essentially what governance is all about. It then also provides the detail with regards to how the council goes about demonstrating its compliance, and you'll see in the fourth column along, which is the documents column, the practice and the evidence that we believe the council has in place in order to ensure its compliance with the code. My colleagues, both with the legal and Mark Lebuck's team, have gone through that list of evidence and are satisfied that the council does have sufficient evidence to demonstrate its compliance with the code. And you'll see obviously the end column of the key officers who are responsible to ensure not only compliance but ensure it remains up to date. The plan is to bring an annual report to you from here on in, whereby we take an annual refresh of the code to ensure it is up to date and the new amendments needed can be brought to your attention so that you at least then have the opportunity to refresh the code and indeed provide the challenge with regards to the council's evidence base through the compliance. Thank you.
Rob.
Yes, very, very brief. Thanks, sir. The report was very comprehensive. It's just column four, responsible for that. Does that reflect the change in the structure of the council or change the council is going through? And we feel that it does reflect any change. Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Phil.
Discussion
of
the
following
paragraph 4th column along talks about those source documents, good practice and evidence. I'm intrigued by some of the evidence as to if we were auditing things, could be an event taking place and a report upon it and the ability to find out what happened as a result of the event. One event I'm interested in, apart from appraisals and KPIs, is staff surveys. It's been years since I recall a lot of discussion about a staff survey, a laborious undertaking to do it. Then there was to be another one. But I don't believe I've seen reports where these things gotten. So that we were saying, yeah, we want to know how the staff now feel about certain issues. And I won't refer back to all the issues that were raised 4 or 5 years ago. But the climate in those issues may well have changed. So how do we find the evidence and track it through for these things like, for example, staff surveys, as I mentioned?
I would need to look at particularly in terms of the staff survey information as to whether colleagues in HR and DO provide that information in terms of the staff survey as well as Kevin McCallum in terms of the survey itself to provide more information as to how you're able to trace and track that. But depending on the issue in hand, you'll find that the survey is going to be then cited as an evidence base depending on the issue. So it may be a matter that goes to actually implement in the appointments committee. Or indeed maybe matters for yourselves in terms of the subject matter in question. So depending on the survey question and the survey issues, we'll determine where it is reported. But if I can come back to you on that particular issue to help, I think the members' general position with regards to wanting to get more information on knowing where they can find it, I can come back to you and provide a little bit more detail to you on that issue.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I think you probably could do with the date that any surveys were commissioned and completed. When it was, where it went from that, and what happened since. The list of dates that show something happened and was done is what has been identified.
And percentage of staff who were involved.
Yes, sir, I can provide that information on certain data points.
Thank you.
It's
Christine.
Yeah, this might almost be a rhetorical question, but just because I've changed committees or committees have all changed, it doesn't mean to say this. Performance appraisal in the back of my mind. I'm a little surprised to find how high. why it is in all these things. How do we square that particular set of circumstances with the departments that haven't done it?
I guess there's two issues here that we need to be clear about. The Code of Corporate Governance provides an opportunity for the council to demonstrate how it meets the requirements of the code. There is, and I think this is the issue that you're highlighting with regards to ensuring that there is compliance with what the council says it will do. And so, whilst there are appraisals are a mechanism to demonstrate compliance with the code, there is also a need to ensure that those who are responsible for appraisals do carry those out, and I think that's part of a separate performance report that you get in order to be able to examine that. So, in terms of the code itself, we demonstrate through appraisals how we ensure compliance, ensure that we can meet the code and its obligations. But as you said, there also needs to be an opportunity for you to scrutinise that what you say is going to be done is done, but that is actually forms part of a performance report rather than this.
Can I just come back on that then and ask, does that mean that the behaviour and integrity bit and all this only applies to some departments? Because some people have not had appraisals for many a long year. So
no.
Whether they've not had it, I understand the point you're making, Sergeant, but the fact remains the code of practice is there for people to follow it, not for people to say we have to follow it, but we haven't managed bits of it. It's gone on too long now, and we're not actually meeting that code of conduct, don't we? Because it's got to be everybody who has a chance to have an appraisal, not just a few people who have it all the time.
Perhaps I can come back on that. In terms of the annual governance state, the update that we call, when that comes back in January, we'll have the details for appraisals, private rate data, the crossings directors, as well as the primary. The last figure I saw was in excess of 97% of
marriage,
and in excess of 90% of staff. But I haven't seen the final, but that will come to yourselves in January with the detail by directors, with the explanation of which areas haven't been done and why.
So we have a party
then,
after all this
time. Well, I'm just going to remember. Okay, I think we've given that one away. Are you happy with the recommendations?
Yes.
Yeah.
So on to item 10, the statement of accounts. Back over to you, John.
A brief report, since last time, last committee considered the accounts, the annual audit report, and the annual government statements beyond that. The committee left that at that stage, we're still waiting for the audit things to be finalised. That came out on the 29th of September. That went to the council public on the 30th of September. So that completed it within the statutory time scales. That leaves just one area outstanding, which is the annual audit letter. Next item on the agenda, and we're waiting for the issue of the certificates. I think Chris will go through that, but obviously there's still an item outstanding on the audit side, so I'll probably best do Chris to take you through that one. But in terms of where we are with statement of accounts, it was published on some time, published on the 3rd of September, so that concludes in terms of this committee, production of the statement of accounts.
Okay, and we have the recommendations?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And particular from the point that Tom made, decided to present our annual audit for 2015-16. This would normally bring to conclusion our audit work for the year in question, but as the previous report references, there is an outstanding local objection. It means we can't issue our certificate yet, and I'll say a little bit about that later. I'll briefly take you through the key issues, and I'll ask members to note the contents. And repeat what Tom's confirmed, page 119 confirms that we did issue a qualified opinion on our financial statements. Our VFM conclusion, as you will recall, in September 18 was except for because of the issues set out in the inadequate Ofsted report. And our letter notes the actions already planned and the further actions that the councils will take and appreciated needs to take in relation to that report. Since September, we've also completed the required work on the whole of government accounts return, which is sent to the NAO for consolidation nationally, and there were no issues to report, which is pleasing. And we're about to finish our work on the certification of your housing benefit plan by the deadline of 30th of November. So should there be any issues that need to bring to our attention, we do that in early in the new year. So really all I wanted to also mention was the section on a number of issues that I do set out in the annual order letter, a number of challenges that were raised in the objection. And just to repeat the message that we gave in September, this is a national issue. A number of such objections have been received across the country. And because of that, the National Audit Office is retaining a prominent central role. So they're still coordinating the position. We've now asked and received from the council all of the relevant information that can be provided, because a number of these transactions date back to the previous century. Naturally, finding the information has proved difficult, but the council have given us wholesome support, and we've now got that information that we're beginning to go through. Each of the audit firms have appointed a lead person who is coordinating for the National Audit Office. And we understand that national legal guidance is still being obtained. Inevitably, with these sort of quasi-judicial areas, the time frames can be quite lengthy. We'll be undertaking our review of the loan portfolio of the council in December, early into the new year. And if I had to estimate a time frame, I would hope that this may come to a conclusion around March of 2017, at which point we would clearly seek to issue the certificate to the council. But in the meantime, as that work progresses and more audit committees meet, we'll be bringing an update to you on the latest position and any findings of note. Finally, I just draw members' attention that we confirm the audit fee charged in the year, which I think is a requirement. I didn't anticipate saying a great deal more, but I'd be happy to take any questions if you have them. Certainly.